is this King of glory that pursues me with his love and haunts me with each hearing of his softly spoken words? My conscience a reminder of forgiveness that I need. Who is this King of glory who offers it to me? Who is this King of angels, O blessed Prince of Peace, revealing things of heaven and of its mysteries? My spirit's ever longing for his grace in which to stand. Who is this King of glory, Son of God and Son of Man? His name is Jesus, precious Jesus, Lord Almighty, the King of my heart, King of glory. Glory, with strength and majesty, with wisdom beyond measure, O gracious King of kings, Lord of earth and heaven, the Creator of all things. Is the King of glory. He's everything to me. His name is Jesus, precious Jesus, Lord Almighty, King of my heart, the King of.
Good afternoon. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm Kenny Foster. I'm one of the pastors here at Grace, and it's been my honor and privilege to know my brother Lawrence, although I never called him that. It was always Ken, Kenito. No, but I never called him Lawrence, but it's been my honor and privilege to have him as a friend and as a brother and to be his pastor, you know, for a number of years. And we are here to celebrate the life of Ken Williams, whom Jesus loved and gave his life for. Ken, I think it was a few years ago, we were on a rafting trip, and he had won, I think this is right, Lisa, he won that big tent. It's a huge tent. And we, you know, it's like 8-man tent, and I had my own room inside the tent. We were on this rafting trip, and, you know, and Ken brought that thing and put that thing up, and, you know, and now there are several of us are in it. It's like, oh my goodness, you know, there's all kind of space, you know. I think that that's kind of indicative of Ken and who he is. Not who he was, who he is. Yeah. He is like a big tent. He had a lot of space in his life for a lot of people. You're evidence of that. You're over here, the other side over there is filled just as well. He had a lot of space in his life. He lived his life well. So Brandon, Logan, Gabby, Lisa, Mom, Dad. His life wasn't wasted. He lived his life every moment. Ken knew how to have fun. And he loved his family. That was evident. And the Lord has taken him home. He's resting from his labors. And so we offer to all of you, Lisa, Gabby, Logan, Brandon, our heartfelt sympathy and our love as we seek to embrace you as long as we can, as long as the Lord allows us, as you mourn and grieve, and you grieve as those who have hope. Yes. We love you. But you know, it is the presence of the Lord that matters. And as we are here today, this is what we seek to celebrate: God's saving work in the life of his servant, Lawrence Ken Kenito Williams. As father-in-law, Reverend Leo Zaletta is going to come and lead us in prayer.
Let us pray. O Lord and God of life, we welcome you to this house of worship in our hour of need, in this hour of death, as we have learned to do in many of our experiences. We thank you for loving us and caring about each of us. Help us to wait before you with submissive hearts. Let this be a time of admonition. Make this a time of opening our eyes and a time of understanding. Help hearts that are hurting. Give us your comfort. Bless those who feel the sorrow most. Lisa, his wife, and children, Gabriella, Logan, and Brandon. Ken's sister, Stephanie, and David, niece Natalie, Ken's parents, Lawrence Kenneth Sr. and Betty Williams, brother-in-law Roland and Ashley, along with niece Eden, and in-laws Leo and Vicky Zaletta, cause the Christian love to bind us close together so that we may share that spiritual strength that is ours through the love of Christ, in whose name we pray, amen.
I knew Lawrence. It's funny for me to call him that because he was always Kenny for me back in high school. But anyway, this is the context of Jesus comforting his disciples. And he's telling them, do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God. Believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, I would have told you that I'm going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you with me so you may be where I am.
To the holy place, past the grave. Please be seated.
Love you all. Love you. Would you pray with me? Lord, we humble ourselves before you in this our time of mourning. Someone we love has been taken from us in what seems way too early. We had expectations for a future filled with laughs and hugs, songs and meals. All these now seem unprepared. But God, we understand that you know us, you know our lives, and today we recognize you know our death. You know our true purpose and our confusion. You know our strengths and our weaknesses. You know our happiness and our pain. Today, Lord, we give over our friend Kenny into your care as if he wasn't there already. You created him and you redeemed him and you gave him purpose. God, you were the source of love in him that we all came to expect and appreciate so much. You're the reason he could listen even when we didn't make sense. Kenny would tell us, and we have to believe, that you were the best part of him. We come before you today, though, God, and we ask you that you would fulfill your purpose for Kenny's life in us. First and foremost, God, that we would love one another and serve your kingdom as he did. Lead us to surrender our lives today to you just as Kenny had done, to turn from the power of sin in our lives and toward the power of your love. Transform our hearts, God, and our minds as you did Kenny's. God, we know that you have the ability to turn our mourning into joy. Take what seems to be wrong, overcoming good, love being buried is what it seems. Help us to see that in the truth of the fact is that in the resurrection of Jesus, God, the love is never ending, that hope is always abounding, that life goes beyond this present life. God, I ask for healing today to begin and continue for Lisa and Gabby and Logan and for Toots. Also for his mom and his dad, his sister, and all the friends that are gathered here among you, God. That the love that these felt as their earthly father, that they will know from you, God, and your people that are gathered around them today and every day, that we will more than fill in the void as you lead us, Lord. God, use our memories of Kenny as a husband, a father, a son, a friend who was created in your image to grow and shape us that we might become a clear image of you here on earth all the rest of our days. Lord, we pray all this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, our Redeemer, and our Lord. Amen.
I've been over there praying that God would take my tears for a few minutes. I'm a crier anyway. So my name is Dane. Lisa asked me to say something about Kenny. And I mean, I sat down and tried to do stuff, and I got 1,000 thoughts and no thoughts. You know what I mean? So I'm going to start with something funny. Well, first, I met Kenny when I was 17 or 18. And, you know, like many of you here, if, well, not doing that. If you were friends with Kenny, you considered him your best friend. Kenny's got about 1 million best friends. And I think Pastor Kenny said it right. My man was a big tent. All right, so Kenny and I went on this mission trip. We were in Window Rock, Arizona, on the Navajo Indian Reservation. And there was, Randy Stonehill was playing in concert, and it was, God, like 2 hours drive away from where we were, but we wanted to go. So Kenny and I and a bunch of other youth that lived in the village and that went on the trip, we loaded up in vans and drove for 2 hours to go to this concert. So the concert place is full of Native Americans and me and Kenny, right? And we're right up front. There's like 600 or 700 folks there, and we're right up front. And all their gear was up, all their guitars and drums and everything. So Kenny gets up, and the stage is only this high off the ground. So Kenny gets up and walks up on the stage and looks at all their gear. Well, the place goes nuts. They start cheering, they're yelling, they're, you know, woo! And Kenny's back here. He turns around, he's like, oh, no. And he comes and sits down, and the place gets real quiet. And about 10 or 15 minutes later, here comes Randy Stonehill and the band. They come out, and he's like, hello, wherever we were, hello, whatever. And it's crickets, man. People were just sitting there like, you know. It was hilarious. We laughed about that for hours, man. Hours. And everything with Kenny's an adventure. Everything. Everything with Kenny's an adventure. We were hanging out one time when we were younger, and he grabbed this road atlas. We opened it up to like Maryland and Virginia, and he goes, all right, let's go there. So I said, okay. So we load everything in his little station wagon, and we take off down the road, and we go to Mama's house to get the canoe, and Kenny and I tied this canoe to the roof of this car, and that was a mistake, right? That was, neither one of us knew what we were doing. Both of us had been in the Boy Scouts. Both of us had been asked to leave the Boy Scouts. So knot tying wasn't for us. We take off across the Bay Bridge, and this thing is like, you know? So we turn around and go back across the bridge, take it back to Mama's to take it off. And before that, we had headed to Mama's across the bridge and realized we forgot something. So we stopped before the toll and turned around and went back. Kenny was like, hey, we'll just do a U-turn, it's fine. So this U-turn, man, we get pulled over, and the cop's like, you gotta pay the toll, man. Kenny's like, yeah, but I just forgot something, you know? Everything with Kenny is an adventure. His family is an adventure. You know, my mom said, I love looking at Facebook and seeing all the pictures Kenny puts up with his family. It's like they... I can't stand Facebook, and Kenny touches people's lives through Facebook. It's ridiculous. So I'm not gonna stand up here and keep doing this. But what I am gonna say when I met Kenny. I didn't know Jesus. Ah, shoot, man. And it did not take long It did not take long before Kenny showed me Jesus. And Kenny never preached to me. He would answer questions when I had them, but he never preached at me. He always showed me Jesus. At every turn. And it is when I heard my call to pastoral ministry, the first person I went to was Kenny to find out if I was nuts. And God, I remember it like it just happened. I was 19, and God called me, and I didn't tell anybody until I got to where I could talk to Kenny, and I told Kenny, well, I didn't tell Kenny. We went down to the Mattapique Beach, and Kenny told me. Kenny said to me verbatim what God had said to me. And that seemed to be his role in my life. Just showing me God. I'm not just gushing, right? You know how in funerals people say the best about people, right? I'm not doing that. I mean, I am, but I'm not. He's the best man I've ever met. Hands down, the best man I've ever met. You know, I think a lot of us in here feel that if we could have half the faith that Kenny had and show Jesus half as much as Kenny did, that we would call that a success, right? But it is because of him, Jesus working through him. I know, don't hear what I'm not saying. But I'm talking about Kenny right now. So it is because of him that I know Christ. It is because of him that I can trust Jesus and be the husband and father and son that I am. It is because of what Kenny did in my life, what Jesus did in my life through Kenny, that my mom knows Jesus, that my boys know who Jesus is. He was my best friend for 30 years. I was driving down the road the other day thinking, man, I would normally be calling Kenny when I feel like this. Anyway, I'm gonna stop. I love that man like crazy. I love his family to pieces. Betty, you know that song you want us to play?
I told her.
Did you tell her?
Yeah, it's coming up.
Kenny and I, when I first learned to play guitar, Kenny would pull out songs and neither one of us knew how they went, so we'd make them up. We'd make up the melody and rhythm to them. And I was going to do that to this song that you picked, but I didn't. But I was going to.
But guaranteed it has Kenny in it. I promised you that. One day that I heard this song, I looked at him and I said, so this is your friend. Every word in this song is Kenny exemplified. So we just want to share with you that this is what Kenny lived for, and Kenny's cause was Jesus Christ.
To be known for loving Christ, to build his church, to love his bride, and make his name known far and wide. For this cause I live, for this cause I die, I surrender for the cause of Christ, and all I once held dear, I will leave. He is all my soul will prize, regardless of the joy or trial. When agonizing questions rise, in Jesus all my hope abides. Jesus, my Jesus, for your glory, for your name. Jesus, my Jesus, I will only sing your praise. Jesus, my Jesus, for your glory, for your name. Jesus, my Jesus, I will only sing your praise. No stature in my brother's eye. I pray it said about my life that I live more to build your name than mine.
Anyone who knows me knows this is not me. I'm not usually the guy who can stand up and say something but to a large group of people, but, well, I wrote something here, but Dane said it better. That's the best man I've ever known. Lisa asked me to do this, and I was reminded of a special summer about 24 years ago. The summer, he and I both were blessed beyond what we deserve. Our weddings were 2 weeks apart, and I asked Ken to do something that I know at the time was uncomfortable for him. I asked him to sing a song at our ceremony that was really special to Marcy and I, but that was Ken. He agreed without hesitation. All right. It was the kind of friend he was. I met Ken in college. He arrived with our friend Dave, his transfer students, and it was the summer before senior year that I really got to know them. I discovered Ken is a fun-loving guy with a big heart. Didn't realize that lifelong friendships were beginning at the time. Our remaining years in college were full of adventures. Early beat the crowd dinners in Lottie Nelson, 7:30 Jeopardy in the apartment, late night trips back to Maryland to fetch ski equipment. But most importantly, our late night devotions on that third floor apartment in Fry in our senior year. Some of the best times of my college years. Five guys, Ken, Dave, Paul, Les, and I, praying to and worshiping a God bigger than any of us could imagine. We took turns leading each other in some kind of story, parable, or object lesson. I don't know if I could recall any of them, but those bonds formed and that day remained. I can still see Ken strumming his guitar, sitting on the softest couch anyone's ever picked out of the trash. Eyes closed, head tilted back, singing his heart out, lost in worship. Man, I'd love to hear him sing. Many nights after devotions were done, the two of us remained on that couch, flipping through his songbook, singing whatever caught our attention, connecting others with God. And as we've heard here earlier today, we know that Ken also had a great heart for his family. One of the other great joys that senior year was getting to witness the beginning of Ken and Lisa's friendship blossoming into something special. Ken loved her, and it's obvious to anyone who's ever been around them through the past 25 years. He would even whisk her away to the mall when she should have been writing a paper with me. Thing is, it didn't end there. Our friendships continued to grow. There were weddings, kids came, our group of friends continued to meet twice, sometimes three, maybe even more times a year. Slip and slide events in Maryland, YFC banquets in Delaware, weekends in Ocean City, corn mazes, camping trips at Cape Henlopen, and then recently it started to turn into graduation parties. We'd laugh about how our kids were growing up like cousins, only funny because it was true, and I can see Ken walking toward me at any one of these get-togethers. Arms out, simple, hey man, and a hug, and I missed you. Later at some point, he'd always ask me, how are you doing? If I responded any other way, he'd quickly center the conversation back. No, 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 I meant spiritually. He was continually challenging me to draw closer to God, and even at the beach, he traveled with his guitar, made sure we would have a time of praise and devotions together. I recently wrote on Facebook about how I didn't get to see Ken in the hospital, but I was on my way there. But the last time I saw him was just September at Hershey Park. He and Lisa decided to bring Brandon and a friend up just for the day, and they were right in our backyard, so Marcy and I made our way over. We had lunch near the Sidewinder. We sat together a couple hours, talked about the latest things going on in our lives, talked about our kids' latest adventures. He was excited about the new church plant that he and Lisa were getting involved with, excited about working with youth and the upcoming launch. And as always, he was asking me where I was spiritually. I know now Ken has the joy of worshiping in Jesus' presence. 1 Corinthians 13:12 says, "For now, we see only a reflection as in a mirror, but then we'll see face to face. Now in part, now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I am fully known." I have to keep reminding myself that I'm only seeing a reflection, and one day I'll get to see the whole picture that Ken is seeing now. I keep picturing him beside his Savior with his guitar in his hands, his head tilted back, singing away. One day I'll join him, but right now all I can see is a reflection, and all I can see is a family missing a husband and father, and I know that I miss my friend.
I've already forgotten. Hi. Forgive my notes, I just wanted to make sure I get through it. I've known Ken 20-some years now, but my favorite story, memory of him, is probably happened about 8 years ago. My husband was pastoring a small Alliance church in Daytona Beach, and we wanted to go away for our anniversary to the Cayman Islands. So we asked Ken if he could come down and cover the service, because it was a small church and my husband was the only staff member, so everything needed to be covered, the music and the speaking, and we needed somebody that could do everything. So Ken was really scared, but he said he would do it, and we said, in exchange, we'll let you and your family stay in our house in Daytona for the week and have, you know, vacation, and just if you can cover the service for us. So they came down and stayed, and he did a great job with the service. And when we got back, we could walk in the front door and the kitchen is there, and I have my pile of mail, so I immediately started going through the mail on the table. And there was a note left from Ken and Lisa, and it said, you know, thanks so much for letting us stay, had a great time, hope you like the picture. So I'm looking around on the table, picture, and I thought maybe they left a photograph that they had taken at the beach, or like a, you know, friend loves at all time kind of thing. And I didn't find anything on the table, so I thought that maybe they were gonna send it to us, you know, that they took a picture and would send it in the mail. And so I said to Sean, I said, they said something about a picture. I said, so watch for the picture, let me know if you see the picture. So he goes to put the luggage away and he calls out from the other room, Summer, I think I found the picture. So I went in the living room expecting him to be holding something in his hand, and he points to the wall, and on my wall is this huge, and I mean huge, abstract art painting on my wall. Who does that? So I find out later that Lisa had tried to talk Ken out of this, but Ken was adamant that no, this was the gift, the thank you gift for Sean and Summer. This is what she would want. And they had bought the picture to match our furniture in our living room, but we had just moved and we were a young married couple. So this was furniture we had bought at an estate sale and weren't planning on keeping. So a few months later, when we went to buy our living room furniture, we had to buy furniture to match this abstract art painting. So we ended up with a living room full of purple furniture, purple sofa, purple love seat, purple chair and ottoman. And then a few years later, we moved up north and put the painting on the wall in the living room, and our new living room didn't fit all of the furniture. So the chair and the ottoman had to go downstairs in the family room, which meant then we had to buy a sofa to match the purple chair and ottoman. So to make the story short, Ken put his mark on my wall and therefore directed the whole future of the design of my home. Which wasn't the way I would have envisioned it, but my home is very cool. In the same way, Ken left his mark on my life as a teenager and kind of directed my whole outlook on God and life. It probably wasn't the life that I envisioned that I would be living married to a pastor, but Ken was really impactful. I ended up marrying somebody with his sensitive heart and who was also called to youth ministry. I met Ken when I was in high school. Him and Lisa ran Campus Life, and they came to my high school and did a presentation. And what I liked about Ken right away, that he was really easygoing, really mellow. He was always kind of like, hey, man, you know, kind of thing. And he was always up for, like, whatever. If we wanted pizza, if we wanted to roller skate, go consignment store shopping, we made him do that. Whatever we wanted to do, he was up for it, and he was cool about it. And you always felt really comfortable with him. So as soon as you were feeling comfortable, that's when he'd ask you the hard questions, you know, how are you really? And it was, he always knew just what to ask you about, and it was always really personal. But because he came into my world, I was comfortable with him asking me those questions and challenging my thoughts, because I knew I could trust him to be cool with my answers, even if my answers weren't cool. And at that time, they probably weren't. In Proverbs 27, 5 and 6, it says that someone who is honest with us truly loves us. And that was Ken. He'd ask you the questions and ask where you were at and challenge you on that, but you knew it was because he loved you. When Lisa asked me to speak about him today, this poem immediately popped into my head, so I thought that I should read it. And it's called I Stand by the Door. And it says, I stand by the door. I neither go too far in nor stay too far out. The door is the most important door in the world. It is a door through which men walk when they find God. There's no use my going my inside and staying there when so many are still outside, and they, as much as I, crave to know where the door is. And all that so many ever find is only the wall where a door ought to be, and they creep along the wall like blind men with outstretched groping hands, feeling for a door, knowing there must be a door, and yet they never find it, so I stand by the door. The most tremendous thing in the world is for men to find that door, the door to God. The most important thing any man can do is to take one of those blind, groping hands and put it on the latch that only clicks and opens to the old man's touch. Men die outside that door, starving beggars die on cold nights in cruel cities in the dead of winter, die for want of what is within their grasp, and they live on the other side of it, live because they have not found it. Nothing else matters compared to helping them find it and open it and walk in and find him, so I stand by the door. Go in, great saints, go all the way in. Go down into the cavernous cellars and way up into the spacious attics. It's a vast, roomy house, this house where God is. Go into the deepest of hidden casements of withdrawal, silence, sainthood. Some must inhabit those inner rooms and know the depths and heights of God and call outside to the rest of us how wonderful it is. And sometimes they take a deeper look in and sometimes venture in a little further. But my place seems closer to the opening, so I stand by the door. There's another reason why I stand there. Some people get partway in and become afraid, lest God and the zeal of his house devour them. For God is so very great and asks all of us. And these people feel a cosmic claustrophobia and they want to get out. Let me out, they cry. And the people way inside only terrify them more. Somebody must be by the door to tell them that they are spoiled for the old life, for they've seen too much. Once taste God and nothing but God will do anymore. Somebody must be watching for the frightened who seek to sneak out just when they came in, to tell them how much better it is inside. The people too far in do not see how near these are to leaving, preoccupied with the wonder of it all. Somebody must watch for those who have entered the door, but would like to run away. So for them too, I stand by the door. I admire the people who go way in, but I wish they would not forget how it was before they got in. Then they would be able to help the people who have not yet even found the door, or the people who want to run away again from God. You can go in too deeply and stay too long and forget the people outside the door. As for me, I shall take my old accustomed place, near enough to God to hear him and know he's there, but not so far from men as to not to hear them and remember they are there too. Where? Outside the door, thousands of them, millions of them. But more important for me, one of them, two of them, 10 of them, whose hands I'm intended to put on the latch. So I stand by the door and wait for those who seek it. I'd rather be a doorkeeper. So I stand by the door. And I think that's where Ken was. He talked about God all the time, but he talked about him as if he were his best friend or his next door neighbor. And he made God accessible to me as a teenager. And he never allowed himself to not be able to relate to the rest of us who were struggling with our faith or not yet ready for it. I heard it said that your calling is when your talents meet your burdens. And I think Ken's burden was that he loved God so much that he wanted everyone else to love God too. And his talents, in knowing what we needed to talk about, in being able to learn about us enough to know what we would like, a huge abstract art painting, his ability to perceive how much he could push us, he used his music, his fun personality, his beautiful relationship with his wife. He positioned himself by the door so that he could see what was going on with us, so that when we were searching, he could grab our hand and place it on the knob. Sorry. The life that he led that I could see when I was a teenager, and the person he was with an unfaltering faith in Jesus, and a person that truly cared about me, those were powerful influences in my young life. Hold on. In Acts it says that in Christ we live and move and have our being. And I love this verse for Ken. because in Christ, it was who he be. Selfishly, I still want him here. But I'm not going to question God's timing, because obviously his ways are not our ways. And I'm so grateful for the time that we had.
Dane and I had the awesome privilege of being in a Wednesday night service with Ken as a part of his ministry at Kent Island United Methodist Church. And I think that if we played this song every Wednesday night, it still would not have been enough for Ken.
Hi, my name is Susanna, and Mr. Williams was my youth leader here at Grace Church, and I've been really close friends with Williams for as long as I can remember. I can't say, speak from my heart without writing it down, so I'm sorry, but I'm just going to read what I wrote. To say in just a few words the impact Mr. Williams had on the lives of every individual he came in contact with would be like trying to know someone you've never met. It's simply impossible. For the past 7 years, I have had the blessing and privilege of knowing and growing under the guidance of the Williams family. In these 7 years, we have shared the greatest of memories that will last a lifetime. During these years, I have had the opportunity to be taught under Mr. and Mrs. Williams as they have taught and led our youth group and Sunday school discussions. To say the least, the Williams family has become my second family and my strongest role models on this planet. Mr. Williams taught me, and so many others, life lessons that will stay with us forever. These lessons include how to love a hateful world, how to share the gospel in many different ways, and how to deal with the most challenging of situations. I'll never forget sitting and talking with Mr. Williams one night about the calamities we face on this earth. I'll never forget the words he spoke as he explained to me that he doesn't know why these challenges occur. He said we don't understand and that it is beyond our human comprehension and that all we can do is to trust in God and in his ultimate and perfect plan. This lesson stuck with me for years, and I hope that it can be encouraged by all those that are here today. Personally, Mr. Williams taught me how to love a hurting world. He taught me the definition of true love. He poured it out upon his loving wife and three beautiful children who he adored. Although the next few days, weeks, months, and years will be challenging and not always easy, he would want each and every one of us to continue living out the faith and the Christian-like mission that he so well displayed. I'll truly miss the excitement he shared with me as we'd hurry into the kitchen to be the first to eat Miss Williams' amazing buffalo dip. And I'm looking forward to the day when I will be able to do just that with him again. To thank him for all the service and love he poured out onto Grace Church and the youth is something no word or gift could ever fully express. But it is something that will forever be that we will forever be grateful for and we will never forget. Although our world grieves with sadness, we can have a hope that will last eternally. And that hope has already conquered death's sting. In that hope awaits the assurance that we will meet again. There will be a day of no more tears, no more pain, no more fears. There will be a day when the burdens of this place will be no more and we'll see Jesus face to face.
Church, and it was senior graduation dinner thing, something. And so he's like, come on, you play with me. I was like, He's like, come on. So we're up there, we're playing, we're in shirts and ties, and he has his tie out like this. And it gets woven into the strings, right? And he's playing, and it sounds like that. And I'm looking at him, and I'm freaking. Because now it's just me playing, and I play like, it didn't sound like that. It was kind of, you know? And he's laughing, he's like, oh, my tie's in here. So he gets his tie out, and while he's doing it, he dropped his pick in the guitar. He's like, man, please, Kenny, please. And then his daughter's like, hey, learn this Israel Hawks.
Your love is everlasting, it's an everlasting love. Your mercy is as new as every rising of the sun. Your loving kindness, better than life.
grace is all sufficient. It's an all sufficient grace. Your power and your glory are forever on display. And your loving kindness, better than life. Oh, 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 it's better. Oh, 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 better than life. Oh, 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 so much better. Jesus, your loving kindness. In all your ways are just, O Lord, you're just in all your ways. And I will lift my hands, O Lord, in gratitude and praise for your loving kindness. Loving kindness is better than life. Oh, 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 it's better. Oh, 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 better than life. Oh, oh,
my name is Brian Ezell, and you have given me an honor in the program. You've listed me as friend. That's an honor to be called Ken's friend. And because you've stated that, I feel like I have to be a little bit honest with you. It was just this morning that I realized Ken's first name was Lawrence. I've known him as Ken or Kenny, and anytime he saw me, it was always Brian or Bri or brother or man. God told me to pray for Ken. to the best of my abilities, I was faithful in that. And God works in mysterious ways, no doubt, because he allowed me to no longer have a job so that I might be able to be with Ken almost every day for almost 2 weeks. I was able to go by and be with him. And so we prayed together. And occasionally took a little walk. Never once did he give any insinuation of fear or discomfort to the idea that, oh, I might be dying. The only concern he ever expressed to me was for his family. And he, I would say, entrusted in me prayer requests for y'all. I will maintain those to the best of my ability. Lisa, you asked me to read a verse. You're incorrect. Psalm 116, verse 15 cannot be read in and of itself separate. The way in which it sits in that psalm, it is indelibly predicated by everything that comes before it. And when you look at your husband and your father's life, you will see that what I have just said is true, and I ask you to excuse me as I read those verses for you. I love the Lord because he hears my voice and my supplications, because he has inclined his ear to me. Therefore, I shall call upon him as long as I live. The cords of death encompassed me, and the terrors of the grave came upon me. I found distress and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I beseech you, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous. Yes, our God is compassionate. The Lord preserves the simple. And I was brought low, and he saved me. Return to your rest, O my soul. For the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have rescued my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I shall walk before the Lord in the land of the living. I believed when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said in my alarm, all men are liars. What shall I render to the Lord for all his benefits toward me? I shall lift up the cup of salvation and call upon the name of the Lord. I shall pay my vows to the Lord. Oh, may it be in the presence of all his people, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his godly ones. O Lord, surely I am your servant. I am your servant, the son of your handmaid. You have loosed my bonds.
Hello. I'm Gabby, Ken's daughter, and I just wanted to share some of the things that I learned from my dad. I learned from him not just by the words that he said, but also in the way that he lived his life. My dad was bold. He was really bold about his faith, and he did things that were out of his comfort zone sometimes, if that's what God was calling him to do. When my dad was sick in the hospital, he would ask his nurses if they were believers, and some of them said yes, and they prayed with us, and they prayed for my dad, and others were reminded about people in their family who had faith, and they remembered their faith when they were younger, and it just brought back that thought of God and the relationship with God. So that was really cool to see. My dad was funny, and he told a lot of jokes. He enjoyed laughing, and he loved making other people laugh. And those who knew him know exactly what I'm talking about. My dad was adventurous. Have you heard Uncle Dane and other people have shared a lot of adventures that my dad took, and that was really great. He took us on road trips to different concerts and going to different places to find new fun food. And he was really spontaneous. He took us midnight sledding once, and he just did that kind of stuff. My dad was kind, and he would just do little things to show us that he cared, like, you know, like the dad things, like fill up my gas tank and bring us home, like little gifts that he finds at Goodwill and stuff that he reminded him of us. but he also loved to serve. And I remember we were driving to my grandparents for Thanksgiving once, and he saw that they were serving meals to people who needed them, and he just pulled in, and we got out of the car, and we served that day, and we kind of made it like a little tradition to find different places to serve at for Thanksgiving, and that was just something that was really special. My dad was loving, and he taught me how to love. I learned so much by the way. He loved my mom, and he was a good husband to her. And how he loved his kids. He always made time for us, and he always supported us in everything that we did. So in Jeremiah 29:11, it says, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future. I know that God has a plan for me and each of us today, and for me personally, I hope that his plan is for me to be more like my dad and to carry those qualities that he had to live for God. Thank you.
As the story goes, one Palm Sunday, we were invited to attend a special one-man drama at a friend's church. Our children were young, of course. We strolled in somewhat late and ended up in the second row. I think you know where this is going. The drama was entitled A Roman Cross Builder, and the person performing the drama began building a cross right on stage, the whole time sharing what it was like to be a cross builder during the time that Jesus was crucified. As you can imagine, the tone of the drama was very sad and serious. Just at the most serious part, one of our children started laughing, as in hysterical and inappropriately laughing. I can remember looking at Ken and motioning for him to take the child out. So Ken took the child out into the lobby while the other children and I stayed behind to watch the drama. At the end, the Roman cross builder instructed us to take a yellow slip of paper from our seats and write a sin that was standing in the way of our relationship with God. Afterwards, we would all line up and nail these yellow slips of paper to the cross that he had built during the drama. Just about that time, Ken came back into the sanctuary. He asked what we were doing, and I explained the instructions, but we couldn't find another slip of paper, so I just gave him my paper, and I told him to write on the back of it. Ken began writing, and one of the kids asked, "What is he doing?" I said, "We are sharing a paper since we are one in Christ." Just then, Ken shot me a not-so-nice look and mouthed, "What did you say?" I told him, I said, "We're sharing a paper because we are one in Christ." To which he said, "Oh, I thought you told her to shut up. He's got a lot to write." When I think of my relationship with Ken, I can truly say that we really were one in Christ, one in which God's love was always the center, always holding fast, always bonding, always transcending. Ken was the spiritual leader of our marriage and our family, and I feel as though this was a role that was easy for him because he just loved Jesus so incredibly much. I had never before met a man who was so passionate about living out the love of Christ in everyday life. This was evident in the way he loved his family, the youth he ministered to, his clients, and everyone else he interacted with. Ken loved God so much, he sought pastoral counsel about even entering a dating relationship with me. He talked to one of the Bible professors who was a pastor at Messiah College to seek guidance and prayer. I remember him telling me all about this meeting. The most amazing part was that morning this professor had been doing devotions with his wife and she had given him a little yellow post-it note with a verse on it. She said that she believed he would need that verse for someone that he would meet that day. And then Ken gave me the post-it note and sure enough, there was Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you, not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future," which from that day on became our verse. Ken was without a doubt the love of my life. From Ken, I learned so much about being a disciple of God. He had a heart for Christ and a joy and a smile that reflected that. Ken was so obedient to his Lord, he would do anything God asked him. Once when he was attending Anne Arundel Community College, he said he was leaving the library but felt something literally turn him back around. Ken followed God's lead and went back inside the library, even though he wasn't sure exactly why. Shortly after that, a student Ken recognized from an on-campus Bible study ran up to him and told him he was so glad to see him, as he had been praying desperately for someone to take him to an important interview that he had in a little while. Of course, Ken gladly agreed to take him. There's also another story that took place during this time in Ken's life when he picked up a hitchhiker. He asked the guy if he was hungry, and the man said that he was. Even though Ken did not have any money on him, he just felt that God wanted him to buy this person lunch. So he took him to the nearest McDonald's, and when Ken got up to pay at the drive-thru, he was pleasantly surprised to find a $5 bill in his wallet. That is such an example of who Ken was and how he lived his life, trusting in God with every little thing. In Ken, I saw someone who was truly anxious about nothing and who gave his cares to the Lord. He always had such a peace. I believe that is one of the reasons that God put us together, since I am, well, sometimes people might call me a ball of anxiety. Even as recent as 2 weeks ago in the hospital, when he was having a heart rate episode in which his heart rate was sky high, the doctor afterwards told us that he had looked right into Ken's eyes and he said, "I just saw such an incredible sense of peace." And I knew that he was talking about the peace that Ken had in Christ Jesus. Ken was one who loved without conditions. He simply loved. Those of us who knew him knew that. He always had a warm, gentle, and kind-hearted spirit that let you know he accepted you and loved you no matter what. In addition to his big heart, Ken was very merciful and forgiving. I was always so amazed how he could so easily accept an apology and be able to just move on. However, I know that it was just another way that Ken followed the Lord. Our ministry together was one that lasted a lifetime. It was always so much fun serving with Ken because he would do just about anything. Once, when we were just friends at Messiah, I was in an international students club in which we had been asked to sing a song in Spanish at a chapel in front of the entire student body. No one in this ethnically diverse group knew how to play the guitar, so I volunteered my friend Ken to play. He learned the Spanish praise song and played his heart out, all the while, he said, not understanding any of the words. He played it so well that after chapel, he told me one of the professors who took yearly mission trips to South America followed him all around campus that day, asking him, did he play mariachi music? After Messiah, Ken got hired as a campus life director, and our first years of married life were spent doing fun campus life clubs and working for a church youth group as well. Throughout our years together, we thoroughly enjoyed working with youth. Ken especially had a heart for young people, and he had a passion for them to learn about the life-changing gospel of Jesus Christ. One of the things I remember most about our ministry together is how much I just loved watching him teach all the youth that he served. He always studied, and he always prepared so diligently, but he always presented in truth and love. Ken and I were not just one in Christ. The kids will tell you, Ken was also someone who loved to have fun in Christ. Oh, the adventures he led us all on. Ken just loved having fun with his family, from camping to beach trips to road trips around the country. I think one of his signature adventures was always trying to stop and find a Food Network restaurant for us to eat at. Those of you who follow him on Instagram and Facebook are familiar with his food posts. So it's reassuring to know the feast he is enjoying in heaven now far surpasses any of the Food Network food. The lyrics to one of our songs, I Can't Fight This Feeling, says, "'Cause you take me to the places that alone I'd never find." I like to think that whenever we were on a family trip with Ken, that is exactly what he did. He would take us off the beaten path, the road less traveled, and together we would experience something a little different than the average tourist did. Whether it was a thrift shop in Toronto, a Mexican bakery in Kennett Square, or an art gallery in Chicago. Ken was the guy who was genuinely kind to everyone he came in contact with. Even when he was in so much pain in the hospital, he would always squeeze each nurse's hands and look them in the eye and sincerely thank them for helping him. He just had that friendly personality that made an impression on people. I experienced a true example of this as recently as this past Sunday. We went to For the World Church, and a woman approached me and told me she did not know me, but that she and her husband had met Ken on a golf course a couple months back. And she went on to say that her husband was single, and so was Ken, so they ended up playing together. And she told me how he had told them all about his family and that she remembered him because he was such a nice man. And just at that moment, Gabby walked up, and the woman asked her, "Are you Gabby?" And I knew that Ken must have talked about each one of us in detail. It was a precious gift to know just how far his love for people went, and the timing could not have been more perfect. A couple months ago, Ken preached one of the few sermons he had ever preached in his lifetime. The topic of the message was on Eric Little, the Olympic runner that Chariots of Fire was based on. In his message, Ken said these words, "I have no idea where God may take and lead me in my life, wherever that may be. I pray that I will follow and obey because I want to be wherever God is and to be in his will." Ken closed the sermon with this scripture from Colossians 3:1-2 and verse 17. "Since you have been raised with Christ, set your hearts on things above where Christ is, seated at the right hand of God. Set your minds on things above. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him." Ken lived this verse out even in his last words, as I remember him saying to the medical staff caring for him, "I am God's, and God has me." Many of you may know that one of the first places Ken and I fell in love was on the dance floor, even though we went to Messiah and we weren't supposed to dance. One of our traditions over the years was that at every wedding we went to, Ken would promise me at least one slow dance. The last wedding we attended was on October 1st, just before Ken went to the hospital. He had not been feeling well, and honestly, he thought he would be headed home before the dancing had begun. However, he started feeling a little better that night, and so he stayed. And that night we were able to dance not one slow dance, but two back-to-back. I remember looking at him and thanking God for the good life and love we shared. And I know that dance was a gift from God himself. Just as Ken was about to enter the presence of the Lord, I assured him we would dance again. And thanks to the Christ we have been one in, I am confident we'll dance again, my love.
Good afternoon.
you have your Bibles with you, if you have an app for that, I would encourage you to turn to John 17. And then hopefully explain why that scripture has been laid on my heart. The verse right before we go into chapter 17 says this. I've said these things to you. This is Jesus speaking to his disciples. I've said these things to you that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation. But take heart, I have overcome the world. And when Jesus had spoken these words, he lifted his eyes up to the heavens, said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that the Son may glorify you. Since you have given him authority over all flesh, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth, having accomplished the work that you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had with you before the world existed. I have manifested your name to the people whom you gave me out of this world. Yours they were, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything that you have given me is from you, for I have given them the words that you gave me, and they have received them and have come to know in truth that I came from you. And they have believed that you sent me. I am praying for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those whom you have given me, for they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I am glorified in them, and I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, keep them in your name, which you have given me, that they may be one, even as we are one. While I was with them, I kept them in your name, which you have given me. I have guarded them, and not one of them has been lost except the son of destruction, that the scripture might be fulfilled. But now I am coming to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they may have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of this world, just as I am not of this world. I do not ask that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. They are not of the world, just as I am not of the world. Sanctify them in truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, so I've sent them into the world. And for their sake, I consecrate myself, that they also may be sanctified in truth. I do not ask for these only, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one, just as you, Father, are in me, and I in you, that they also may be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. The glory that you have given me, I have given to them, that they may be one, even as we are one, I in them and you in me, that they may become perfectly one, so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you loved me. Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundation of the world. O righteous Father, even though the world does not know you, I know you, and these know that you have sent me. I made known to them your name, and I will continue to make it known, that the love with which you have loved me may be in them, and I in them. Thank you, God, for your word. I have thought, and I have prayed, and I have wrestled, and then prayed some more about what God truly wanted me to share today in these moments that we have together. And it was this scripture, this whole of John 17, it's this high priestly prayer that Jesus is praying. It is a passage that I hope is explained and heard in such a way that brings us comfort, that brings us joy, esperanza, it brings us hope and healing for today and in the days to come. Because I believe it shows us and gives us this example of a perfect picture of submission to the will and the authority and the sovereignty of our Father God. And how Ken lived his earthly life in that same submission to the will, the authority, and the sovereignty of God, our Father. There are only a handful of people that I know that are completely sold out for the cause of Christ. People I look up to, people who have helped my walk tremendously by their example, people who have changed lives by just a touch or a smile or God's Spirit moving so fiercely through them that you cannot help but be captivated by the aroma of the risen Christ. And one of those people is Ken Williams. I first met Ken in 2012. How may you ask? Of course, through Lisa, because everyone who meets anyone meets through Lisa, right? We actually all met really through the book that Lisa wrote called The Christmas Hippo. It was actually when Lisa contacted me. It was August 14th of 2012. You sent me a message on Facebook. That's how we first interacted. He said, I don't know if you know who I am, but we met through that, and together we were trying to figure out a way to surprise a guy by the name of Bob Wessel. On December 2nd of that same year, we did surprise Bob, and through that, we became good friends, and I got to know your family. And over those years, you know, you've let us in on a lot of things as far as being good friends. You know, there's good friends, but then you know you've become family when you're allowed to enter your garage, right? You're welcome in our garage. But over those years, I learned a lot from Ken. We met on occasion. We hung out at the pool a few times during the summer. We played some volleyball, talked a lot about God and ministry. And by the way, here's just a few random things about Ken you might not have known. I got these off Facebook. If you're on Facebook, you can take a look at these. I just picked a few, but it says, my grandmother gave me my first guitar. She bought it from a Naval Academy chaplain renting a room from her and gave him a discount to teach me how to play. I still have the guitar and I still cherish it. He said, I think laughter is the most beautiful sound in the world. He said, I've been hunted by a bloodhound. Yes, it is fun when you're not in trouble. Had the opportunity to travel to Israel and see many amazing things. I've been blessed with a great family and believe that my wife and kids are better than I deserve. I love God. I love to cook and I watch the Food Network all the time. I secretly want to enter a food challenge because it looks like a lot of fun. And we, not a cooking food challenge, but we had an eating food challenge that we had. We had the triple at Jake's Wayback Burgers and it was tough. Right, Logan? What was your time? Like half of what it took me. Yeah, right. No time at all. He said, I don't mind getting lost. I'm afraid of spiders and heights. He said, my dad took me to the first concert that I ever went to, the Bee Gees. Well, you can run away. And I have a love for youth ministry. And then this other one I saw, it was the top 10 things to avoid, and I think these should be true of all of us. Top 10 things to avoid whenever possible. Avoid eating spaghetti and meatballs in bed. Walking on top of folding chairs to avoid disturbing people in the aisle, only to have one of the chairs fold up on you, bringing you down, down, down. Going crabbing with your dad and uncle the same day of your high school class reunion without sunscreen. Thinking of something funny in church and laughing out loud during a presentation of the Passion of the Christ, right? Trying to eat an Ann's famous footlong hot dog while driving in your work clothes. Flushing a Wonder Woman toothbrush down the toilet just to see if it would work. By the way, it does not. Accidentally locking your entire family and yourself out on a second floor deck to have dinner while vacationing in Ocean City, New Jersey, having to call out to strangers on the street to come and free you. I love this next one. Taking the key out of the ignition. Kids, close your ears. Taking the key out of the ignition while you're driving 60 miles an hour down I-95 in Daytona, Florida in July while on family vacation just to see what would happen. He said, not good, all I can tell you. Taking a shortcut through a train tunnel at night with your friends to get to Harper's Ferry, West Virginia faster, and changing a flat tire at night in the rain on top of the Bay Bridge. These are all cool things that we can learn from Ken. And I learned a lot from Ken. And one of the things that was first and foremost in his walk with the Lord was his prayer life. Ken would tell you he was not one to stand up in front of a congregation and preach. He did this past August, as Lisa shared, totally put him on the spot in front of people. I was like, so you're preaching in August, right? And he was like, well, let me pray on that. And he brought an incredible message, an incredible message. It didn't look like he was going to pass out at all, but he said he did everything wrong. He locked his knees. He was sweating like crazy. He thought he was going to go. But he got through it, and it was wonderful. But he was definitely a prayer warrior. When Dawn and I called Ken and Lisa to see if they wanted to be part of a new ministry and a new church launch, his first reaction and action was, well, we'll pray about that. And when they said yes, we knew they weren't saying yes to us. They were saying yes to whatever God was calling them to. And maybe this is why God laid this scripture, this John 17, so heavy upon my heart, because this is Jesus praying the heart of God. See, Ken had so many gifts that God blessed him with, his singing, guitar playing, his passion for youth and young people, but prayer, I love to hear Ken pray. Because it was always from his heart. And it was reflecting the heart of God. But prayer sometimes is confusing. You know, I thought about that. You know, when we first got the news about Ken, our reaction and our action to go into action was to pray. And we prayed daily and hourly for God to touch his body and to heal him physically, and we caught glimpses of answers to our prayers. There was a time in which that he had come home, and I remember sitting and talking with him, and he said, I'm going to be at church on Sunday. I just want to worship my God. And he did. We set him up in this nice little comfortable chair, and he sat back and he played and he sang, and the Spirit filled that room so much that day. But it wasn't long till he was back for more tests and more discoveries, and we, the faithful and the ones who were praying that maybe were just trying to find their faith through something here, that we were praying in the midst of all that was going on. We couldn't figure it all out because it seemed like for every step forward, we would take two steps back. But I remember Ken from that first day, he held my hand. And while I was there supposed to be reassuring him, he reassured me that no matter what, he's like, God's got this. He said, if I have another day here, I'm blessed. And if I wake up in heaven tomorrow, I want to have been a blessing to others. And the first night he was in the hospital, we sang, "Whom Shall I Fear?" And we sang it out. And I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. And if the God of angel armies is with him, what more could we ask for? On his last day on this earth, we were gathered around him and we sang again. And it was during the first verse of When We All Get to Heaven. Sing the wondrous love of Jesus, sing his mercy and his grace. In the mansions, bright and blessed, he'll prepare for us a place. And it was at that moment that God received him into that place that he prepared for. And he said, "Well done, my good and faithful servant, but what about the prayers? Come on, God, that's not what we were praying for." Because even the most faithful could cry out, "Why? Why, oh Lord? We want answers." I could give you a list of many reasons why we want Ken here to continue walking with us here. I could give you a top 10 list of people that I'd rather that you have taken. I'm sorry, that was... And then there were those who prayed whose faith is not strong. Maybe they're new to the faith. Maybe they didn't have faith, you know, in Christ at all, but they knew Ken and they knew that they felt that they should be praying. They felt that urging to pray for him and they prayed as well. And maybe they look back on this and they say, "Look, God doesn't hear me when I call. I don't even know about this Jesus thing. I know Ken was sold out to him, but come on, I prayed, right? But I'm here to tell you, God heard you. God wants to comfort you. God wants to heal your heart. And I am here to tell you that the God of the universe is madly and deeply in love with you. And the God of the universe is madly and deeply in love with Ken and wants nothing more. The God of the universe wants nothing more than to have you come fully into his presence when your time on earth is done. The God of the universe is so deeply in love with you that he sent his son, Jesus, fully God, fully human, to make a way. And even Jesus prayed not for his will to be done, but for the will of his Father in heaven. And let me just tell you how much Jesus loves you. We go back to our scripture today in John 17, starting in verse 20. It says, "I do not ask for these only," speaking of his disciples, "but," he says, "but also for those who will believe in me through their word." It was 2,000 years ago that Jesus prayed this prayer. And guess what? You know what that verse means? It means he prayed for you. The God of the universe prayed for you that day. And a little bit further on, he said this in verse 24. And I hope that this may answer some of our questions today. Jesus prayed, "Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am, to see my glory that you have given me because you loved me before the foundations of the world. Spurgeon said it so great. He said, "O death, why do you touch the tree beneath whose spreading branches weariness finds rest? Why do you snatch away the excellent of earth in whom is all our delight? If you must use your axe, use it upon trees that yield no fruit. Then you may be thanked. But why will you chop down the best trees? Hold your axe and spare the righteous. But no, it must not be. Death strikes the best of our friends, the most generous, the most prayerful, the most holy, the most devoted must die. And why? It is through Jesus' prevailing prayer, Father, I desire that they also whom you have given me may be with me where I am. It is that which bears them on eagle's wings to heaven. Every time a believer moves from this earth to paradise, it is an answer to Christ's prayer. A good old divine remarks, many times Jesus and his people pull against one another in prayer. We bend our knees in prayer and we say, Father, I desire that your saints be with me where I am. But Christ prays, Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am. And in this way, the disciple is at cross purposes with his Lord. The soul cannot be in both places. The beloved one cannot be with Christ and with us too. Now, which of the two who plead shall win the day? If you had your choice, if the king should step from his throne and say, here are two supplicants praying in opposition to one another, which shall be answered? I am sure, though it were agony, you would jump to your feet and say, Jesus, not my will, but yours be done. You would give up your prayer for your loved one's life if you could realize the thoughts that Christ is praying in the opposite direction. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am. Lord, you shall have them, and by faith, we let them go. Ken knows this separation that we have is only for a short time. We will see him again because we have the promise and the hope of eternal life on the beautiful shores of heaven. And all of us here can be part of that promise, and we are part of that hope. Why? Because Jesus desires for us to be with him. And desire to be with Ken and to be with all the saints who have gone before us. Father, I desire that they also, whom you have given me, may be with me where I am. Jesus is praying and pleading through infinite desire that you, all of you, will be with him. You don't have to pay. You don't have to wait for the right time or place. This is the moment that we have. Jesus paid it all to him I owe. He took our place on the cross. He didn't just pay for our sin. He took the entire weight of all of our sin, for Ken's sin, for Lisa's sin, for Gabby, Logan, Brandon. He took the entire weight of your sin so we could be free and live in the presence of God, our Father. Ken knew this, and there was nothing more important to Ken than sharing the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Do you love Ken? Do you look up to Ken? Were you ever amazed at the abundance of life that he possessed? Ken was pointing you to Jesus. You can't get that kind of stuff on your own. Ken's love came from God. He looked up to the hills where his strength comes from, and the abundance of life came from the Spirit of God who sustains us and sustains Ken and provided him with comfort, the same as God will do for each of us today. I'm going to turn this time over to Pastor Kenneth Foster to lead you in an invitation that is better than any invitation that you've ever had, and I hope that you will accept it.
And that invitation comes from the Lord Jesus Christ himself. Within that prayer, when he prayed, Lord, Father, I would that they would be with me, that they may see my glory, the glory that you gave to me before the creation of the world. Christ is calling. He's calling you. He's asking you to come, to be with him. And if you're here this afternoon and you can't say that you know that you would be with Christ, you can't say that. I want to pray for you, and I want to invite you to come just as you are. Come just as you are. Receive this invitation from the Lord Jesus Christ. He's not asking you to clean up yourself and make yourself better. He wants you just the way you are. He's not asking you to come and do something grand for him, because that's he's done it for you. As Pastor Scott has said, he's already borne the weight. He's borne the punishment for you. And now he calls you to come. Come, be with me. Let me ask you to close your eyes everywhere, in here and in the all-purpose room as well. If you don't know, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, if you've never received that invitation from him, and you would like to do that, just put up your hand. I'd like to pray for you. In a moment, we're going to sing right after I pray. And if you would come, there will be people here who are waiting to show you from the Bible, show you from the Word of God, just how to receive that invitation from the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Our Father in heaven, how grateful we are to you for the Lord, his love for Ken, his love for us. Lord, we are grateful that he died in our place to rescue us, and that he rose again from the dead, and that he's gone ahead of us to prepare a place for us, that where he is, we may be also. Lord, that's our desire. Our desire is to be with you, Lord, and everyone that you desire to be with you, Lord, they have the desire to be with you. Father, I don't know who is here that doesn't and hasn't received that invitation, but you do. I pray that you would enable them, Lord. Give them courage to come just as they are, to come and receive this invitation from you. Let the power of your Spirit work and move and do, Lord, what only you can do. For it's in your name we pray. Amen. Amen. We're going to sing. Scott's going to lead us in Just As I Am.
Just as I am. Of God.
Still need to talk. If you need to, maybe you're afraid to come, but if you need to talk, please see me, see Scott, see one of us. We'd love to point you to the Lord, to help you receive that invitation that Christ so graciously has extended of eternal life.
May God himself, the God of peace, sanctify you through and through. May your whole spirit, soul, and body be kept blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do it. Amen.
You may be seated.
Cause we win in the end. It won't be about strength.
they will continue to play that an instrumental. And what we would like to ask is that starting in the back, if you would like to make your way forward down the center aisle to pay your last respects, and then return out through the back doors by the side aisles to head over to the fellowship area. Now this has been simulcast over there. They have to do a couple of things to arrange the tables and chairs for the repast. But just to let you know, just to take your time coming through and get out there, and then we'll have the family have some quiet time in here so they can say their final goodbyes as well. Blessings.